Hi, I'm Michael Correa, and this is Psych Exam Review. In this video, I want to go over colorblindness in more detail. So in the last video, I mentioned that this term colorblindness is a bit misleading. And that's because people who are colorblind, it's not the case that they're blind to color. It's that they can't see some colors, or they have difficulty differentiating certain colors. But they still see, in most cases, a very broad spectrum of colors. So there's different types of colorblindness depending on which cone type is affected. So if you look up types of colorblindness, you might initially be a bit overwhelmed by all of these different names. But there's actually a fairly simple system that these names follow that can help you to understand these types of colorblindness. Now, chances are, for an introductory course, you wouldn't be expected to memorize all of these types of colorblindness. But if you're interested, I thought I'd explain this naming system. So essentially, the naming comes from the three different cone types. So the first, in this case, is red, so this is going to use the Greek for first, pro, right? So we have red, then we have the green, the medium cone, this uses the Greek for second, deuter, and then for the third, we have tri in Greek, and this is for the blue cone type, or the short wavelengths. And so there's two things that can happen to one of your cone types. One thing that can happen is it can be missing completely. This is more rare, but it can happen. So if you're missing a cone type, we say, we use the suffix anopia, which means without vision. So then we simply attach this without vision to whichever of these cone types is affected. So you could have protanopia, would be missing the first cone type, the red. The second type would be deuteranopia, missing the second or medium cone type. Or tritanopia would be missing the third type. Then another thing that can happen is that the cone's sensitivity can get shifted. And this is the more common type of color blindness, is that one of the cone types is shifted, usually the red or green. So if it's your red cone type, the long wavelengths that's shifted, it's called protanomaly. If it's the green, it's called deuteranomaly. And this is the most common type of color blindness, deuteranomaly. And then if it's the third cone type, the blue short wavelengths that are shifted, then that's called tritanomaly. Okay, so what do I mean by shifted? What's actually happening here? Well, let's take a look at that spectrum that we saw before with the sensitivity for each cone type. Okay, so you can see if the green, let's say the green type were completely missing, well, you see that wouldn't just affect this green area here, it would influence anything that uses the green cone, right? So the idea here is, let's imagine that we only were looking at the red cone here, right, the longer wavelengths. Well, how do we tell the difference between this level of stimulation of red and this wavelength over here equally stimulates it? So how do we distinguish these two colors? Well, the answer is we have the other cone overlapping. So if I have this level of, you know, absorption on the red cone, but a low level of green, well, then I see it as red. But if I have that same level of stimulation on that red cone type, but I have a higher level on the green cone type, the medium wavelength, well, that tells me that it's green. But now we can see if one of these is missing, if I'm missing that green line here, now I can no longer distinguish between these two shades. And that's why people who have this type of color blindness have difficulty distinguishing between green colors and red colors, because those are equal stimulation on that, you know, long wavelength red cone. Okay, so in the case of anomaly, what happens is that these lines get shifted. So if you have protanomaly, right, that's an anomaly of the red cone, the first type, the long wavelength, that gets shifted to the left in our diagram. And that means the overlaps are going to be in different places, and there's going to be some areas where, you know, it's harder to tell the difference between red and green colors. And in the case of deuteranomaly, which, as I said, is the most common type of color blindness, it's that the medium cone, the medium wavelength cone, the green, is shifted to the right. And in some cases, it can be shifted where it's essentially on top of the red cone. And then you have a really hard time distinguishing colors, because a lot of these red and green shades have basically the same level of stimulation. And so you can't, you know, to you, they're the same thing. Okay, so that's essentially what happens in this anomaly. Now, these red and green types of anomalies, often called red-green color blindness, right, that refers to multiple types. That can refer to protanomaly, deuteranomaly, etc. This was first described sort of scientifically by a guy named John Dalton, and he was a chemist. And let's see, I have a picture of Dalton here. And this is why this red-green color blindness is also sometimes called Daltonism. And there's sort of famous stories about Dalton, who was a Quaker, you know, his colorblindness being apparent because he would do things that didn't quite fit with the very stern, severe Quaker lifestyle that he's expressing quite well in this picture here, such as showing up in a bright red robe because he thought it was gray, or supposedly buying his elderly mother stockings, which were red when he thought they were actually blue. Okay, so this red-green colorblindness, Dalton noticed that his brother was also colorblind, and this suggested that there's some sort of inheritance associated with colorblindness. And indeed, for red-green colorblindness, there is. This is not the case for the tritanopia or tritanomaly, but in the case of protanomaly, deuteranomaly, or protanopia and deuteranopia, these are called, this type of colorblindness is called a sex-linked trait. So what does that mean? Well, it means it's linked to whether you're male or female. So if you remember from an earlier video, males on their 23rd chromosome pair have an X chromosome and a Y chromosome, whereas females have two X chromosomes. All right, so here's the male and here's the female. Okay, so what does this mean? Well, the genes for the long and medium wavelength cones are located on the X chromosome. So what this means is if you have a defective version of the X chromosome, if you're a male, let's just imagine that's, you know, the defect, then if you have a defective X chromosome, then you will be colorblind. But if you're a female and you have that same defective X chromosome, it's okay because you have another X chromosome that has the correct information. So for a male to be colorblind, all he needs to have is this one defect on the X chromosome. For a female, she needs to have the defect on both of those X chromosomes. It needs to be the same defect on both X chromosomes in order for her to be colorblind. And this is why colorblindness is many times more common in males compared to females, because males, one bad X chromosome and you're colorblind, whereas females, you need to have both X chromosomes have this defect. Right? This also is why sometimes colorblindness is a common pattern is for the grandfather on the mother's side to be colorblind, and then the son to be colorblind as well. So what happens is the grandfather gave that, you know, he has one faulty X chromosome, he gave it to the mother, who's a carrier, and then she then has essentially a 50% chance of giving that to her son. If he gets that X chromosome, he'll be colorblind. Okay, so that's why we say that colorblindness is a sex-linked trait. Remember, that's not all types of colorblindness. So tritanopia and tritanomaly have nothing to do with the X chromosome. And there's also types of colorblindness that occur because of environmental exposure, or you could have a random mutation. And so it's not only the case that this is how you are colorblind, but it's the more common situation. Okay, so now the real question that you're probably thinking is, well, what is colorblindness like? What does it feel like to be colorblind? What does it look like? So we can look at some examples that will try to demonstrate this to us. And you've probably seen something like this before. This is an Ishihara colorblindness test. Right? And the idea here is that if you have normal vision, you look at this, you see the number 74. But if you have some version of red-green colorblindness, and depending on how severe it is, you might see the number 21. And that's because this is written in a way that you can see there's different shades in here. And an important idea for this, you might wonder, why don't they just write it in normal? Why isn't it just solid color? Well, we want to try to limit the effects of the brightness, right? So different colors aren't just different wavelengths. They can have different luminances, right? They have different levels of brightness. And we want to confuse that, right? We don't want it to just be, if it was two solid colors and one is slightly brighter than the other, then you'd be able to see it, even if you couldn't see the color. So that's why we have these different brightnesses, different saturations. So we have different luminance, different saturation, all these mixed up colors here. And that's to ensure that the only difference, the only thing that lets you see the numbers is the color and not the, you know, the brightness of these different colors or the level of saturation or something like that. We want to ensure it's just the wavelength that's allowing you to see the numbers versus somebody who can't see them. And if you have a type of colorblindness, you wouldn't just look at one of these slides to determine this. So if you can't see the 74 here, well, okay, we know it has to do with the red-green type, but we don't know exactly what type of colorblindness you have. We'd have to do multiple tests to determine, you know, which, is it the red that's shifted, is it the green that's shifted, or is one missing, or, you know, how much is it shifted? So we'd have to do multiple tests to determine that. And it's also possible, but very rare, to have sort of multiple types of colorblindness at once. So if we went back to our list here, it could be the case that you could be missing more than one. You could have only one cone type, which is very, very rare, but then you'd be very limited in the colors that you can see. You could actually have no cones at all. That's also possible. You only have rods, and in that case, you only see in black and white, and it's very blurry, because remember, cones allow you to see fine detail. And also, rods don't work very well in the daylight. They're for low light conditions. And so if you have that, your vision during the day is going to be sort of overwhelmingly blurry because the rods aren't really working at that time. But in low light, you'd be able to see, but it would still be kind of grainy and fuzzy. Okay. I want to mention, you may have seen some YouTube videos of these EnChroma glasses. These are glasses that claim to restore color vision for people who are colorblind. So how are these working? Well, first, we have to understand these don't work if you have an anopia. If you're missing a cone type, they aren't going to be able to do very much for you. So they're only working for anomaly, and usually for the red-green anomaly, either protoanomaly or deuteranomaly. Okay, so what are they actually doing? Well, they're not restoring color vision. They're not adding any information. What they're doing is they're taking information away. They're filtering out some wavelengths. So we can imagine if these red-green lines were too close together, right? So let's say we had them overlapping where we had, you know, two points on this line that appeared to be the same stimulation, right? One that's actually green, one that's actually red. What these glasses would do is they selectively filter out certain wavelengths. So if we filtered out one of these wavelengths, now these stimulations are going to change, right? And now we're going to be able to distinguish between, you know, this one is going to be sort of cut out, so it's going to be reduced, and this one over here where the overlap occurred isn't. And so what's going to result is we're going to be able to distinguish these two colors now. It doesn't mean we're going to see them as red and green when we put the glasses on. It means that now we can distinguish two colors that we previously couldn't. So it used to look the same to us, and now they look slightly different. That's what these EnChroma glasses are essentially doing. Okay, final thing is some demonstrations of what colorblindness feels like. And this is a site I'll post in the video description. So you can look at a picture here, and then you can simulate different types of anomalies or anopias. So you can go in and see, okay, the red weak, the protoanomaly, it's going to look something like this. The green weak deuteranomaly is going to look something like this. Blue weak. And you can go through and try this. And you can also upload your own file and then sort of see what would this look like to somebody with these different types of colorblindness. Now remember, in the case of the anomalies especially, you know, it's a shifting, so it's not going to necessarily be shifted exactly the same way for everyone. So this isn't a, you know, perfect demonstration. If you have a friend who's colorblind, it doesn't mean you're seeing exactly what they see. But it gives you a better idea of what they experience. Okay, so that's colorblindness. I hope you found this helpful. If so, please like the video and subscribe to the channel for more. Thanks for watching.